Our topic will be Christian friendship and its role in spiritual formation of a Christian. Today we heard about a problem, which is within a person who belongs to nation of God, like David.
Не просто христианская дружба, а христианская дружба и ее роль в духовном формировании христианина. Ну вот, мы сегодня слышали в самом начале, Саша нам напомнил относительно такой проблемы, которая существует у человека, который принадлежит народу Божьему, который следует за Богом, который становится даже очень видным в народе Божьем, такой как Давид. И берут все с него примеры, потом бабах, и такое что-то страшное случается, и только все головой качают. Единственное, что нам остается с облегчением вздохнуть и сказать: ух, ну слава Богу, не я один такой, значит, и если Давид такой, значит, еще не все потеряно. И тем не менее, мы ведь понимаем, мы знаем, что это совсем не то, что Давид хотел, и это совсем не то, что Господь хотел, чтобы так было в нашей жизни. Мы призваны к тому, чтобы расти. Расти как христиане, расти как те, которые похожи на Христа. И вот есть разные перспективы, разные представления о том, как формируется духовная зрелость, как стать настоящим христианином, или, как богословы говорят, как происходит освящение христианина. То есть не спасение, вот уже ты, Господь тебя принял по вере твоей, ты уже пошел за ним, а как тебе стать похожим на него? И вот есть такие известные разные позиции. Некоторые люди говорят, что никак без усилия не получится. И в Писании написано, что Царство Небесное усилием берется, восхищающее усилие, и совершающие усилия восхищают его. А другие говорят: нет. Просто нужно не стараться, а нужно поверить всем сердцем. Принять веру и спасение, автоматически все получится. Заповеди его будут исполняться автоматически. Но эти как бы две противоположные такие позиции.
The growth, becoming more mature happens. How what we call sanctification. It's not when you believe in Jesus Christ alone, but when you become like Him. So there are several positions. Some people say that without an effort, you cannot do this. And the gospel says that the kingdom of Christ is forthfully advanced. But
some other people say, no,
you need to not just strive alone, but you need to accept Him with all of your heart, and you need to believe Jesus, and His commands will be automatically obeyed. So those are two opposing positions. There's another position that is not very natural for the Protestants, but for the Orthodox, they have a well-spread position. In order to become a good Christian, it is only possible through a church when you receive these sanctity in the church and the things that the priest does, and it comes from the church. So today we're going to look at another position, let's call it number four. But it actually joins in itself the other three, and we'll see how that is done, if that is at all possible. So I would like to presuppose and then look at the text in the book of Philippians, that the way to Christian formation goes through Christian friendship. When we say Christian friendship, we understand that it is not just any mere friendship. It is special kind of camaraderie. It's relationship within a family of Christians. It's when we heard one theologist say here that this is the mishpat, where it's in society where everybody lives for each other, loves each other. So that's a Christian friendship that we're striving for. So we're going to look at the peculiarities or the essence of Christian friendship. When we start reading the first 11 verses of Philippians 1, and we will go into talk about the foundation of Christian friendship, the development of Christian friendship, and the result of Christian friendship. And I will tell you right away that the first one deals with all three parts, actually, deal with a certain time. And the result of a Christian friendship is the future. We will see the development of Christian future based on the past. And the foundation has a special dimension that we will see. So let's read. But I want to make...
будучи уверен в том, что начавший вас доброе дело будет совершать его даже до дня Иисуса Христа. Как и должно мне помышлять о всех вас, потому что я имею вас в сердце, в узах моих, при защищении и утверждении благовествования вас всех, как соучастников моих, благодати.
Since I have you in my heart, for whenever I am in chains or defended, and confirming the gospel, all of you share in God's
И молюсь о том, чтобы любой ваш еще более и более возрастал в познании и всяком чувстве, чтобы, познавая лучше,
вы были чистым и преткновенным в день Христовом, исполненным плодов праведности Иисусом Христом, славу и похвалу Божию. To discern what is best and may be pure and blameless until the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. So the first thing we pay attention to is the foundation of Christian friendship, and it is in the form of this text. At the time when people received any text, for example, in Pergamus rolls, it was important to see what was written in the very beginning, because it can be some philosophical tract or some story, maybe an exciting story, or a letter, as it is in here. So whenever the text begins with an introduction of who is writing and who it is for, that means it is a letter. But Paul, in this letter, put in here something more than just a reflection of what this letter is about. He says here three things, and these first two verses of the first part, when he talks about the foundation of Christian friendship, first of all, he talks about the centers, and it's not just one center, there are two centers, Paul and Timothy, and then he talks about the recipients. And the recipients are all the saints in Philippi, in Jesus Christ, and it says there, with deacons and overseers. And then the second verse, he sort of says about what is equally true for the senders and for the receivers. For all of them, what is true is that they have a special relationship with the Lord. And not with just the Lord, but what he writes here, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So God, but here he's also God the Father and God the Son. And if you read several verses later, we will see also mentioning of the Holy Spirit, and especially in the second chapter, he says, if there is any fellowship of the Spirit, then complete my joy in having the same thoughts and so on and so forth. So Paul pays attention to the fact that the relationship between the sender, Paul and Timothy, and the recipients, the saints in the Philippi, they are filled with the grace and peace from the one who also has a relationship in between himself. This is God who is three-une God, God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And also let us pay attention very briefly here that Paul here turns to and directly gives a perspective. Even though it is obvious from the text of the epistle itself that Timothy wasn't writing the letter, but he wants to share his responsibility of the sender with somebody else. And it is interesting because for the largest part of Paul's epistles, he adds somebody else. He says, I'm not the only one who's sending, but I'm together with Timothy, or I'm with Timothy and Silas, or there's another person that he talks about in one of the epistles. So that tells us that he has read this letter together with somebody, or he shared key ideas, and he says, this is our joint letter. And then he talks about himself and Timothy as servants, as slaves. Maybe that's not a complete translation. Maybe it's just, you know, a godly translation. But the, what is said here is a servant.
Слуга царю, отец солдатам. Может быть, вспоминаете и школьное стихотворение, когда учили, может быть. Вот это вот слуга царю, это
so
гораздо
it is
больше, чем
one,
просто обычный человек.
One of those, poems that we read in school, that the colonel is servant to the king, but also father to the soldiers. So this is how Paul is writing when he writes the servant of Jesus Christ. This is the kind of title that sets him into the position that I am just a servant. I am fulfilling my duty. And we are all saints. Moreover, you have deacons and overseers. So that's probably one of the very few times when he and his epistles writes about deacons or overseers or elders in the context like this.
In other words,
he gives respect to those he's writing to. Therefore, the foundation of Christian friendship lies in the fact that Paul, who writes the word of God, that he passes on, that through which the message to the people who live in the city of Philippi is passed on. And he remembers about the relationship within the Trinity, as he shows in the second chapter when he talks about Jesus Christ, as it says here, being the very image of God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but he lowered himself and he accepted the image of a slave. So, secondly, what Paul does is he shows through conveying this grace and peace from the Lord. That's the kind of a relationship within the Trinity, between the persons of this triune God that we spoke about recently. That's the kind of relationship that there should be, the foundation for Christian friendship. And they pass on grace and peace. So we have seen the Christian friendship is based on relationship with God. And let us now see how it is developed. And if it's a relationship that develops, that they go down. So then it talks about the development of Christian friendship from 3 to 8. I thank my God every time I remember you. He speaks here right away that when he thinks of those who he writes to, he thanks God every time he does so, every time he remembers. It's not just a relationship between Paul and Timothy and those who lived in the city of Philippi, who they visited several times before this time. But it was a special remembrance about their mutual story or history of relationship in the past. And if God is involved in the history of relationship that we have, then all of these memories for Paul are filled with grace. So he, God, who began his good work in you, in us, I'm not going to be very detailed here, I'll just remind you that it was last week I went to the city of Philippi, second time, my family and I visited, and we spent a day at these ruins of this ancient city. And now I feel like I belong there. I can clearly imagine how Paul, we went there by ship on purpose in order to understand how Paul comes from Neapolis and then he goes to Philippi. So you know what happened there? You know that story very well. In Acts 16, it says how the church in Philippi was started by conversion of actually many more people, but he pays attention to three in particular. A lady named Lydia, a servant girl who has no name in there indeed, and the chief jailer, who was obviously a former officer of Roman army. You know, when people were retired, they got this honorable, not very strenuous service. I'm not going to stop here for a very long time, but I can't miss remembering that it wasn't without a purpose, that these three completely different people, from one part, a woman, and by the way, a woman, it wasn't just any woman, it was a businesswoman, she was a chief of a large company, we spoke about that recently, and then we were talking about a teenage girl who could be compared to some drug addict who was a promiscuous woman, who is, you know, shows the social difference between them, but they went to the same community, and there was a same church. And then there was a third guy who was a man who would never imagine searching God and going for a place where people worship the God of Jews. or experience ecstasy that this teenage girl addict experienced when she was, the, so to speak, prophesying, saying that these are the men of God who came to tell you about the way to salvation. The jailer was a practical man. He was never involved in these women prophecies kind of things. And now these three people, they're together in one church. And if we remember on top of that, that was the time that for many, the same as many years later, for Jews who prayed every morning, they recited this prayer, thank you, God, that I'm not a pagan, I'm not a woman, and I'm not a slave. And now let's take a look. That's when Paul writes, this is the same Paul who prayed that particular prayer, most likely, and now he's remembering, okay, these are my friends, God. Who are they? And he remembers each one of them. And there are three people who we talked about, but there are very many more that God found from the very beginning. How can he forget how God once did when he brought these people to himself who were so far away from God, and now they're one family, now they're friends, and this friendship is developing among them. And if we had time to remember from the history of church, from our church, maybe we will be doing that a little bit later. And when I look at all of you, my friends, and I'm thinking about each one of you, for example, there's Sister Marina and Brother Andre and Brother Sasha, and many, many of you. When I remember of that first day, I remember that first day when I saw you. I still have that well etched in my memory. Each one, you were different. And now I'm remembering that it is something that God does in such a way that I would probably never have the fellowship, actually so close a fellowship with all, each one of you and all of this church so many years after this, when we have gone through so many things together, when we know the grace of God.
Взаимоотношения имеют историю, которую важно помнить от первого дня.
The relationship is founded on this history that is important from the very first day until today. We will leave behind the question as to when we count our history, but let's think but when Paul was writing this letter, this was 61, 62 AD, when he was in prison, and it was 13 years ago after he just founded this church in Philippi. Do you remember what you did 13 years ago? How was your relationship with people in this church? You know, our history, the church history of our church is much even longer than 13. I can remember talking to brothers Herschel and Robbie in Denver when we planned and we were thinking how wonderful it would be to start a church together in Kyiv, or meetings in the House of Architecture Church, first time in 1994 and second meeting in 96 or 97. And perhaps we can remember even earlier, because our church began from the House of Architecture Church, because brothers Herschel and others and Robbie, they came. So, and the House of Architecture started back in 1988. I remembered when we were meeting at the apartment of Vasily Davidyuk. We could go back and back remembering, thinking about common relationship in Jesus Christ, solidifies our relationship with Christ. As we read in verse 8, God can testify how I long for all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus. In order to love others, in order to love you, I need to experience Christ's love. And I know that you can love each other, you can love me, only when you have experienced Christ's love. Because that is the very foundation that was uniting us. So when we saw it, that very first day when we met each other and we started talking, when we found that this person knows the love of Christ, God revealed himself to him or her, and now we're brothers or sisters. And so the disciples, before they started being able to love, they had to experience the love of Christ that was shown to them through the washing of their feet. So Christian friendship is strengthened when we remember our common history, triple relationship, and continue turning to God, we continue remembering friends. When we turn to God, we continue to remember friends. That's what Paul is doing here. Every time I pray, I remember you. He probably has a very long list. There were Corinthians and Thessalonians and people from Berea, and he had special place, and now he turns to these with a letter that is full of special friendship and a family kind of relationship. So he says, every time I recollect you. So when we remember each other, then is our memory connected to the memory of our God? And if we have this ability to see friends through God's work in them, then we will be able to take a look and to see how much God has revealed to each one of you here over the last year. So the result of Christian friendship, the result of Christian friendships is probably the most foundational here. Paul has very many things written in these recent verses, some important, significant points that could be set apart and considered separately, but we're going to just scratch the surface of this process. So one of the things about Christian friendships is looking in the future. And this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight. This is for the future. And that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless until the day of Christ. The day of Christ is the future. When Christ comes for us, he remembers the past, he knows the foundation, and he's targeting for the future. He's filled with the fruit of righteousness in Jesus Christ for the glory of God. So for the result of friendship, Christian friendship is based on our understanding of the future. It's based on the fact that we understand the love that grows more and more. You know, back in the 4th century, I think in the end of the 4th and beginning of the 5th century, it was a well-known in the history of Christianity preacher whose name is... He's one of the Johns. And he said that love is one of those things you can never have enough.
Недостаточно, and, ее хочется еще больше.
In other words, it's insatiable desire for more love. You want more and more love. And by the way, what kind of love is that? You would say, a love for whom? But if we look at chapter 2, verse 2, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Here, it is obvious that he talks to love to each other. And if we keep reading, that one of his purposes is to help them in the troubled times, when there are different thoughts that separate them into groups, and he alienates people, and he's taking Euodia and Syntyche, saying, please, share the same mind, don't separate the church. But if we read the Bible wider, all of it, then we will see that in 1 Thessalonians, Thessalonica is a city that Paul visited after Philippi. It says there, and may God fill you with love for each other and for everybody. With that same love, we are filled for you. And we read already in the Gospel of John when Jesus says, whoever has my commands and obeys them, he's the one who loves me. What kind of commandments? I give you a new commandment, one, love one another as I have loved you. So the true love is revealed through our love to each other, and it reflects our love for God. Therefore, here Paul writes in verse 8, God is my witness how I long for all of you in affection of Jesus Christ. The love that I accepted is the love of Jesus Christ. This is the kind of love I have for you. So some of the words about that kind of love. First of all, that is the love that is not sentimental. You know, the Russian translation says here, so that I pray so that your love may abound in the knowledge and in every feeling. Where indeed this feeling is not the word from the original. It's probably a difficult word for translation. And it's probably more difficult to understand without thinking hard about it, but it corresponds more to discernment. And I think in English, in one of the translations, It says depth of insight. So it's the depth of your understanding, of your discernment, so that your love will be deeper in understanding. In other words, it could be said that this is the kind of discernment that relates to how we start understanding what for that person who we love would be better and what would not be better. And this we would call the moral insight. What is good? What is bad? What is good? What is best? And as it says in another translation of the Bible, it says, with all discernment, with every ability to tell apart. So I'm praying that your love will grow more and more in discernment and every ability to say one thing apart from another. So this knowledge and discernment are results of love. And the other way around. The person doesn't know first, and then loves. No, he loves. And then he knows. One very well-known theologist, he says, we cannot know something until we love it. And it deals with everything, with God's creation, and including humans. We cannot know a person deeply if we treat him without love. Well, but how can love produce more and more discernment or moral understanding or insight? I'm not going to stop with this for a very long time, but let me say that it is only when love becomes our attitude of the heart. I will give you an example to make it clear. If we love a person and we regularly spend time speaking with them, then we easily discern that if something is happening, we will notice it right away and say, what's wrong? What happened? And here's another example. If we, for example, like quality coffee, very good quality coffee, and if it becomes our habit to drink every morning at 7 o'clock very good coffee, then instant coffee or any kind of coffee or, let's say, some poor quality coffee that you will Miller yourself, it's not going to be good enough for you. And if you don't drink it at 7 o'clock in the morning, something goes wrong with your day. So that's your habit. So what if at 7 o'clock in the morning we drink not the kind of coffee that we're used to, not the quality coffee, we will be able to tell it apart immediately. It becomes our insight, our understanding. If our love develops more and more day after day, if it's not just within one day, but if it becomes our habit in a good sense of this word, then this is what it means to have spiritual formation. Because little by little, over time, through prayer and meditation, we become a loving person. You know, it's easy to say, love Jesus with all your heart, and then it's going to be easy for you to fulfill all the commands. Yeah, that is correct. If we love something, that it is easier to do something for that person. But indeed, to have that mature love, for that love to become bigger and bigger, stronger and stronger, it needs to be cultivated in us. It needs to be developing in us every day. And this is where there is that edge, where people argue, when people say that in order to become a mature Christian, you need to strive harder. And others say, in order to become a mature Christian, you just need to believe in love. And both of them are actually correct. And that's the amazing edge, the amazing, when we love, the more we strive. And then we strive better, the more we love. And if at some point we saw how wonderful the person is, and you say, oh, that's a great person. Each one of you here in this church, because each one of you knows the Lord Jesus Christ, and that is why each one of you is precious for me, for each one of us. If we know that, then what happens then? There comes a time for us to cultivate this relationship, for us to meet with each other, if possible, in small groups, or here in the meeting, to call each other. I don't have enough time to meet with all of you, but what a blessing it is for me that I can meet regularly with some of you, with some of the brothers and sisters with whom we were able to meet almost every week, or sometimes even twice a week. And I feel how that Christian friendship doesn't only develop, but it gives a push to my understanding, to my love for the Lord. I am learning from my brothers and sisters. This is the way God commanded to us to become growing, to become mature. That's how Paul demonstrates about Philippians. When he says, from beginning with verse 3 and on, I thank my God every time I remember you, and so on, as we read in every prayer, and for all of you, praying with joy for each one. And you know, if for that, we need to have not just love, but also to have prayer, and we need to have knowledge and wisdom for the spiritual formation. All of them are connected with our relationship. They don't just act separately, they all act together. And if we develop those habits, the habits of prayer and fellowship, thinking deeply or meditating what is good for that purpose, conversation with a purpose, with a person, then this facilitates our relationship that builds our growth for each one of us. And by the way, let's speak about knowledge. Sometimes we can hear that knowledge is something that there's a Christian knowledge and then there's secular knowledge. And yes, I understand. I understand the desire and a fair desire to step away from the secular, to be pure, to become closer to the saints, to the ones who are chosen saints, to each one of us, to walk away from all this secular away. And different people do it in different ways. Some people say, I'm not going to go study to a secular school or university. I'm not going to study all of those courses that can also just blind my thinking. Or some people say, I'm not going to even fellowship with non-believers. I will always strive for the group of believers, and I will culturally step aside with different hairstyle, different clothing styles. You know what I'm talking about. But you know, the common knowledge, the knowledge about the God's creation, we need it in order to get to know each other. Here's a simple example. I think that each one of us can remember when we were young and youthful, if some of you grew up without mother or father or both, I apologize. But if you remember your mom and you remember how much you loved her when you were still a child, and then you grew up and you became an adult, then that love is different. And that love is because you know life differently. You don't just know the Bible or separate points about life. You grew up. You have much more knowledge about life. And that's why your love to this close person is more mature. So, that's just an example. We could talk about this for a long time. I know I need to close. I am taking more time than I was originally expecting. But I want to say that the love that is spoken of here, that Paul is mentioning, it is the love that also bears fruit on top of everything. It doesn't only cause us growth, it's not only practical, but it also bears fruit. It is fruitful. And it talks about that in verses 10 and 11, that исполнены плодов праведности Иисусом Христом, славу и похвалу Божию. So that you would know every good thing and then become so that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless until the day of Christ. You know, I remember one day, I wanted to talk about fruit a lot, but I want to give you one personal example. Maybe several, maybe two examples, if you allow me. This day is a special day for me. First of all, very early in the morning, we went to say goodbye to my youngest son and his wife, who went to study in America. They lived with us for a very long time. For the last half a year, we drank coffee together and talked in the morning together in the same house. And it was very difficult for us this morning to say goodbye. And I think that it is a demonstration of the fact that when we spend time with each other, especially with those people who are very close to us,
then
that gives development, it brings fruit, it helps us see something with the eyes of the other person. It helps if we don't agree with the person to tell more about our own perspective, and we develop when we see and we have this regular fellowship. But there's also another example that I wanted to share to you. Today is the 25th of July. 2021. I was exactly 40 years ago at a baptism in Kiev. It was the very first one after decades of baptisms being forbidden, open baptism at the Dnipro. And there were more than 50 people there. Many of those were my friends. And there was one young woman who I didn't meet at the time. I met her several weeks later. Her name was Irina Arkhangelska. And sometime later, she became my wife. That's when she was baptized. So let me tell you that as I told you, when Apostle Paul was thinking about those three very distinct people in the church of Philippi, I can also tell you that there was no way that I would imagine that we could live with Ira Arkhangelska for 37 years together. It's been 37 years almost. We were too different. She enjoyed Beatles and Pink Floyd, you know, Genesis, all of these stuff. And, well, I liked non-Christian music too, but it was Tchaikovsky and Beethoven and not all of those things. We read different books. We had different traditions in our families. And I grew up mainly among believers, and I literally, before I went to Moscow, I had very few non-believers friends until I started studying at Moscow University. She grew up in a city where at the time wasn't a single believer, not a single church. It was a new city in the Volga region. A wonderful person was her father, who's a Communist Party member, and I called him. He was the Baptist communism. He wasn't drinking, wasn't cussing, but he was not a believer. So Irina and I were very different, and I remember how God started working in her heart, and I remembered how God started working in my heart several years before that. And I can tell you that what I know about God, I largely know through the eyes and the heart of Irina Arkhangelska. Of course, now she's Irina Tymchenko. And that is something significant when we understand
that
what the Lord calls us to is not some cold Christianity that is built only on commandments. Do this, don't do that. This is what it says here, and this is what it says there. It's not even, you know, frivolous or light Christianity where God will forgive you anyway. You just need to believe and follow Him. Everything's going to be fine. And it's not the Christianity that is tied through the church like something mystic, something deep and unknown. No, it is a Christianity that God calls us to. It's the Christianity of growth, of maturing in Christ. When we grow and become closer to Him, become more like Him, and it happens at the same time through all of these three aspects. First of all, through, not just through church, but through this family of friends, through the Christian friendship at the Church of God, where we found the same people as us, sinners, called by God at some point, and now we can grow together with each other, remembering every time what the Lord has done in the lives of each one of us. And when we pray to God, we can remember each other. And when we see what God did in the lives of each one of us, then we remember how much we have yet to grow, how much we can still improve in our lives. And we do so because we love. Because we love each other, and we were able to love. And first of all, because God revealed His love to us once in our lives, and we saw His love, and He revealed His love because we first saw His love through somebody else, through some person. Everybody knows at least one person like that. If not for that one person or several people, we wouldn't even know the love of Christ.
чтобы мы продолжали любить не только друг друга, но и окружающих людей,
чтобы мы продолжали давать это свидетельство о его любви. Giving the testimony of His love, and in this way, the relationship that we have in Him and the relationship that is between the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are going to be passed on further and further among people. And I promise that you are going to have a time to fellowship. You know, I really tried, but I don't think we have that much time to talk. Don't we have 5 minutes, maybe?
Если вы хотите
okay, maybe 5 minutes.
Дополнить,
so if you want to,
потому что ведь я учусь у вас.
Supplement
я люблю вас,
what
когда
I say with something
говорите
that you say,
что-то, что I will be very grateful, чувствую, что
because I'm learning from you. I enjoy when you're telling
подумать,
me where I could grow in or think differently. I accept that with gratitude from you. Or maybe you have a question. And every question, there aren't any wrong kind of questions, but the questions help us understand and see the same story, the same point, but from a different angle. So please, anybody wants to say anything or ask? Andre, am I doing the correct thing?
When
we got together with the preacher brothers, we said that Andre already did this, when he said he's preaching, and then he have sharing. Oh, can he also tells us that we have more time, so this is great. Andre, maybe you can actually facilitate, that would be great. Oh, everything is so easy. Hello. Let us now break up into small groups of three. And don't we have any questions? If there isn't any question, we can formulate one now. When the first question is very simple. Have you ever had in your life a person like that? If you have had that one human like that, to whom you got to know the love of Christ, share today, and through which relationship your understanding of Christ is growing. So there, it's a simple question. I don't know if we're going to have enough time beyond that. But don't just answer yes or no, but you tell about that person. Who in your life was helping or is helping you to get to know Jesus Christ and how that is happening. Yeah, make small groups, because with the group is bigger, and if it is possible, we would be able to have a speaker from some of the groups.
Ми трошки поділилися. Я думаю, що зараз час комусь від групи сказати, якщо якась хороша думка є, просто до мікрофону підійти і сказати. Це всіх нас підбадьорить. Ми ж, окрім того, що ми в маленьких групах, друзі, ми ще й в великій компанії, друзі. Ну, хтось хоче сказати щось? Підтримати всю церкву? Я знаєте, я ніколи не хочу змушувати, я просто хочу підбадьорити, що якщо немає, то не відчувайте себе винними. Якщо хтось хоче сказати, то, будь ласка, скажіть. Я думаю, що ми будемо практикувати більше і більше до цього звикати. Є хтось?
Я захотів сказати, ви знаєте, я зараз подумав, тому що вопрос дружби. Это в какой-то степени это, ну как бы это правильно сказать, так что понятно было, это особый вопрос, это вопрос в какой-то степени интимный, он ну, бывает болезненный. Я не знаю, как у вас, но если я чувствую, что у меня нету...
I don't know about your experience, but when I feel that I don't know...
Всегда можно найти друзей.
Well, you know, praise God, I have children and wife, and there's a family, and you can find friends within your family. But whenever I stay alone, it can be difficult. And it seems to me that our thinking today, the words that Paul is saying to us today, that the Holy Spirit left behind, not just for the believers in the Philippi for 2,000 years ago, but also for us, the believers here in Kyiv. I think this is an encouragement so that we would actively be friends. And on the one hand, be friends because this is the way how the Word of God tells us that we need to be more like Him in this regard, to be more growing, maturing. But on the other hand, it's because we can see that people around us, they need friendships, they need us. Therefore, when now you don't have anything to say, maybe it is also because the topic is such. The topic that isn't exactly easy You need to experience it, go through it internally. And I want to encourage you, so when you leave, when all of us leaving this room, would go carry away with us, not just say, oh, it's nice to have thought about friendships, let's move on, we'll next time talk about something else. No, but this topic, it touches each one of us, our growth, our relationship.
Дружбу, потому что я почему-то вспомнила Василия Ивановича, когда я пришла в церковь к нему, а он только организовал.
You know, I'm remembering not only friendship, but also Василий Давидюк, who I met when he just organized a church after having left the Baptist movement. And most likely he felt God's love in everything, in every regard of his life. And as long as I spent time there, he also always finished his sermons with a love for Christ for him, a love Christ's love for him and his love for Christ. And there were many hard experiences in his life and in my life, and after using this note of love in the end, I was able to always light up and be filled up and keep going in life. So I'm just remembering that as a good example in my life. By the way, I also am remembering that point when the House of Architects Church was organized. For us, for some of us, this is Middle Ages story because it seems so long ago. But for me, it seems still relevant. Yes, it is the beginning of the 90s, but do you remember what was in the beginning of the 90s? The brother Vasily Davidyuk was acting like a hero. I think he was excommunicated, or was they wanted to excommunicate him. What do you mean? Believers are supposed to meet with believers, and all of these people who are have wrong haircuts, have manicures, have makeup, coming in the wrong clothes. Can you be friends with them? That's why Vasily Davidyuk had these sermons of love. He understood the God's love in our lives, the whole essence that when God works through us, not when we are friends with the people who are like us. And when we search people who are like us, but when our heart is open for relationship for everybody. So thank you for that memory. Maybe anybody wants, anybody else wants to speak up? We have about 2 more minutes.
Добрый день всем. Я просто хотела сказать, что эта тема действительно она обширная.
Hello, everybody. I just wanted to say that this topic is indeed wide, and it would be nice if you could continue this topic for the future, the studying of this topic, and the question is how many friends can a believer have, what kind of foundation for the friendship is, and many
из Нового Завета, потому что
many questions, and it would be,
все-таки мы живем больше основываясь на Новый Завет, да?
Чем старый, да? Чем ветхий. We live more based on the New Testament, don't we? More that rather than the Old Testament. So therefore, we would like to have passages from the New Testament as the foundation on which to stand, and then we can form our relationship with believers, and not only believers, of course.
Знаете, кажется, когда один ребенок в семье, то
as I walk back, I want to say that you know, it seems that when you have one child in your family,
знаете, я видел одну семью, в которой 17 детей.
It's hard to imagine having two, but if you have four, it's hard to imagine number five. But I saw one family that have 17 children, and I think they were all friends with their parents. Maybe they don't have a friendship where they spend a lot of time individually one on one, but I think we have even much more time to ability to contain than we can think of.
Okay,
I think if this is it, then let's stand up and pray. Thank God for being able to touch upon an important topic today.
Господь, я благодарю за каждого брата и сестру, которые сегодня здесь с нами, с которыми мы вместе.
Lord, I thank you for every brother and sister who's with us today, and with whom together we were able to read the word that is addressed from you to us, because you want to continue working in each one of us in such a way that we will be filled with your great joy. The epistle to Philippians is an epistle of joy, the joy that is in you, Lord, because you know these amazing, precious, deep relationships within yourself, between the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And you came in order to bring the knowledge of that kind of relationship to us as well. Here in the church, Lord, we are partakers of that. We thank you that today you tell us that this relationship indeed is not just any relationship, something that is only for those who are special people of God. It's not that something that we can only have in the heaven and something in the future, but it is the kind of relationship that you reveal yourself through today, and you want us to grow in these relationships today. So help us be attentive to the Holy Spirit that works inside and works on each one of us. And we praise you for your love, that you call us your friends, and you said in such a way that you are not calling us your servants or slaves anymore, not even slaves for the king, but you call us your friends. And we thank you for this wonderful, amazing, deep, heavenly friendship. We praise you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Сідайте, будь ласка. Зараз у нас час для пожертвувань. Можу прочитати.
Now everybody have a seat. We have prayer request.
Мали групи, тобто християни, довге время збираючися і общаючися.
The foundation of Christian friendship that we have is in the small groups, which is the people Christians who are getting together and they are gathered around Jesus Christ.